Let us start the last remaining portion of the steam turbine itself. Steam turbine itself. Now, what happens here? What is the nozzles operating in the off design condition? Let us consider a nozzle as in this figure, which also shows that pressure ratio P0 by P. What is P0? We know that P0 is termed as a stagnation pressure. Means a free-flowing fluid when operating through a nozzle or some other passages, when suddenly brought to rest without any isentropic, without any heat transfer as well as without any work transfer from it, then the condition of it is defined as the stagnation condition, or the pressure thus created and at the particular point of stopping the fluid is called stagnation pressure. Here, what we are doing here is P0. What's P by P0 is the pressure considered divided by the stagnation pressure varying along the length of the nozzle. So whatever may be the pressure P0, the pressure is always varying from this end to that end. Pressure is always varying from this end to that end as per the cross-section area of the nozzle itself. Now, inlet condition is stagnation point at T0 and T0 itself. This is the inlet point. Now, which is assumed to be constant. We are thinking that stagnation point pressure, we are keeping the inlet at stagnation pressure and stagnation temperature, which if it is suddenly stopped the flow, it will create this type of force at this type of temperature itself. So we are thinking that in other sense, we are thinking that we are starting the flow from the entrance to which is at totally stagnated or static. And there from it is creating velocity with going from the up to the end of the nozzle itself. So static means initially it was stopped, and then due to the presence of pressure and other things, it starts moving and velocity is created. Here the velocity is zero itself. The pressure at exit plane of the nozzle is denoted by PE, which is given here. This is the exit plane of the nozzle. This is the converted nozzle itself. We know what is it is a converted nozzle, which means its pressure, its cross-section area is the maximum at the entrance and minimum at the exit, where it is steadily reducing from entrance to exit itself. Now, the pressure at the exit point of the nozzle is denoted by PE, and the back pressure is defined as PV itself. What is the back pressure? Means when you are supplying the nozzle, when you're supplying the fluid to your destination, say on turbine blades, we'll estimate due to the friction and other things, a back pressure, certain pressure is created which will try to stop your flow. Which this pressure is important and is defined as back pressure, which is shown here. This batch pressure you can create by means of a valve. We did not open the valve fully. We have reduced it so that a certain amount of up to your requirement, the pressure is coming out up to your requirement. Now, as the back pressure is varied, you can vary the back pressure through this nozzle itself. You see, as the back pressure is varied, the mass flow rate and the exit pressure, plane pressure, pressure exit divided by pressure stagnate is also varying. Definitely, if you can vary the back pressure, the exit pressure PE itself, it will vary, and the ratio of exit pressure PE by PE will also vary as shown in the figure itself. Now, let us go through the pressure distribution here. What is shown here? This is PE, is the X. X is the fraction of vapor in the stream itself, in the steam vapor air mixture. P and P0 is the, but in the ordinate, it is the pressure, existing pressure multiplied by stagnation pressure, which is equal to 1 here, means pressure is equal to the stagnation pressure. So there is, you see, there is no velocity of the fluid, it is starting from the stagnation, and it is this to P1. It is this stagnation pressure, it is raised to 1, which is equal to where PE, the exit is equal to PE is equal to PB. But whatever with the back pressure, it is exactly equal to the PB itself. And P exit is more than the back pressure. If you have the back pressure equal to P exit pressure, then that the nozzle will not, there will no flow of vapor through the from the nozzle itself. So you have to increase, go to this situation where PE should be more than the P vapor so that it can go out from it. So at the point four, from four itself, one, the PE is reducing, PE is increasing itself, and at the point four, it has become, P has become, up to the, from here to here is 1, 2, and 3. This point, P is equal to PP. Means exit pressure is equal to vapor pressure or back pressure, or there is no flow. And from the point 4, P is more than PE, so it is now flowing itself, and it's also, the ratio is varying accordingly itself. Now, when PB is equal to P0 back pressure, just have told you, there is no flow, absolutely no flow, and P exit by P0, is equal to 1, means P exit at it is equal to the stagnation pressure, and both sides is stagnated as designated by the point 1 in the upper here. And as designated by point 1, if the back pressure is now decreased, if you reduce the back pressure to a certain extent up to the 2, we can control back pressure by Mr. Falk, such that PB to the P0 is less than P star by P0. What is P star? It is the critical pressure of stagnation. Just a few words of the stagnation itself. When M is equal to 1 at the throat itself, means when the flow is equal to the velocity of flow at the throat, discharge can be the maximum. So that maximum amount of omega is maximum there, and the nozzle is says to be choked. It is incapable of allowing more discharge. That is the maximum discharge it can do, and incapable of allowing more discharge even with further decrease in exhaust pressure itself. This discharge is defined as the critical discharge, and the properties of the throat under this condition defined as critical properties. So the critical properties are noted by this star itself. So again, we are thinking that there is no more increase in discharge. That is, velocity is maximum, and you cannot increase the discharge anything more. So discharge is stationary at exit pressure, and in the exit pressure, discharge is known as critical discharge. This is the maximum or critical discharge which is possible. Now the back pressure is lowered to the critical pressure itself. If the point at point three here, at point three, the choked limit. Back pressure is lowered to 3.3 when M is equal to N is equal to 1 and P is equal to PV. When PV is the back pressure is decreased below the critical pressure but equal to exit the pressure itself. At point 4, this is here, and here is the point 4, the back pressure itself. There is no increase in the mass flow rate itself, and P is equal to P star. Pressure exit is equal to the pressure. Critical pressure itself, and ME at exit, Mach number at exit is equal to 1. So the drop in pressure P to PV occurs outside the nozzle exit. So this is the choking limit, which means that the given stagnation condition, the nozzle is passing the maximum possible mass flow. The choking limit, choke we know, is the maximum possible mass flow is possible here, right? Because for the given stagnation condition nozzle, possible means stagnation is stable, means there is no velocity at the end. It is from here, the maximum possible mass flow is possible here. Now, let us consider a convergent divergent nozzle, which will show here afterwards. This is the convergent divergent nozzle we show here. What you see here, P0 is the stagnation pressure, and P0 is the stagnation temperature itself. There is no flow here. And at P star is at the throat, it's a maximum stagnation pressure. Maximum stagnation pressure, by the maximum discharge is possible here. And even if you reduce the pressure, you cannot increase the discharge. And here P is the exit, and back pressure, if there's a chamber here where you can create the back pressure, and back pressure is given here as per the nozzle itself. So what we are saying here, let us consider the convergent divergent nozzle. Point 1 designates the condition when PV is equal to P0, just I've told you there is no flow. PV is delivered by the pressure, PP is lowered by the pressure given by 2. Here, back pressure from 1, it was reduced to 2. So, but PV or P0 is equal, always equal to 1. So, PV is delivered to a certain extent, so that PV is delivered by P0 is less than 1. If PV is equal to P0, there is no movement, but PV delivered by P0 is greater than PP star by P0. Means stagnation pressure, critical stagnation pressure is more than, still more than, still less than P0 itself. That PV itself. So PV is still less than PV. Still less than, more than P0 itself. So the velocity increases now by in the convergence section itself. But so that PV, back pressure divided by the stagnation pressure is less. Back pressure is less, so the flow can occur. But the velocity increases the convergence, but M is equal to 1 occurs, or less than 1 occurs at the throat. Means Mach number or velocity of flow is less than the 1. Mach means less than flow is less than the velocity of sound itself. The convergent divergence section acts as a subsonic diffuser. This is convergent divergence section means here. This is access subsonic diffuser. It is already diffuser itself because it is increasing velocity in terms of pressure itself, but it is called subsonic diffuser, which pressure increases and velocity decreases itself. Here, pressure increases and velocity reduces itself. Point 3 indicates the back pressure. Here is the point 3. In the point 3 here, it is the back pressure in which pressure increases and increases the back pressure at which M is equal to 1 occurs at the throat, but diverging section acts as a subsonic diffuser. The point 4 indicates here. So that the point 4 here, it is indicates that on one other back pressure fall, which flow is isentropic throughout and diverging section acts as a supersonic nozzle. For one another back pressure for which the flow is isentropic throughout and the divergence section acts as a supersonic nozzle with a continuous increase in pressure and continuous decrease in velocity. So PAA is equal to PVA. This condition of this pressure, if the pressure ratio is lower than loop 5, then further decrease in the exit pressure occurs and drop in pressure from PE to PB occurs outside the nozzle itself. Means back pressure, exit pressure becomes equal to back pressure itself. And between the back pressure between 3 and 4, flow is not isentropic in the fiber. Between 3 and 4, flow is not isentropic. Means there is flow, heat flow takes place in the diverging part. And it is accompanied by an irreversible phenomenon known as shock. Shocks occurs when the flow is supersonic. And after the shock, the flow becomes subsonic. So, if the flow got the shock, then flow is reduced, speed is reduced, the rest of the part acts as a diffuser. So up to a certain portion, the pressure is supersonic, and after that, it is So after the back pressure, flow is indicated by point B, the flow outside the nozzle is isentropic. With pressure continuously, decreasing and velocity thus increasing, but a shock appears, just again a shock appears at the exit of the nozzle. When the back pressure is increased from B to A, the shock moves upstream. When the back pressure is further increased, so you are going on increasing and shock moves to downs upstream and reappear at the nozzle throat where the back pressure corresponded through. So since the flow throughout is subsonic, no shock is possible. So what has happened? Back pressure between 3 and 4. Back pressure exists between 3 here and 4. This is the back pressure itself. Between 3 and 4 flow, is not isentropic here because there is a heat transfer can take place in the diverging part. Here it is diverging part because you see this is the diverging part, the flow is there, because it is all this, always it is move all movement from 3 and 4, it is showing in the diverging part itself. Flow is not here isentropic, but the diverging, in the diverging part is accompanied by irreversible phenomenon known as shock. Shock occurs when the only the flow is supersonic, and after the shock, the flow becomes subsonic. So there is a sudden decrease in the velocity of flow from supersonic to subsonic. We'll caught a shock there in the breast of the duct, acts as a diffuser where pressure increases and velocity decreases. Properties vary continuously. Properties discontinuously across the shock. The back pressure indicated by point B. The flow through the nozzle is isentropic itself. Back pressure is indicated by point B. Then flow throughout the nozzle is isentropic itself. And now, pressure continuously decreasing, the velocity increasing, the velocity increasing, and the shock appears just at the exit of the nozzle. So we are expecting this shock from supersonic to subsonic. Then at the exit of the nozzle, near the exit of the nozzle, the back pressure is increased from B to A, shock moves upstream. As indicated, when the back pressure further increased, the shock moved upstream and appeared at the nozzle throat, where the back pressure corresponding to 3. So this is the flow throughout the subsonic, no shock is possible. So what we have decided, due to the shock, the flow decreases from supersonic to subsonic itself. Now let us go for supersaturated flow itself. With superheated vapor, when a superheated vapor expands slowly and isentropically, then condensation within the vapor begins to form when the saturated vapor is reached. As the expansion continues below the line, this line to the wet region, condensation itself, condensation produces gradually with the progressive decrease of quality, but the progressive increase of the vapor content and increase in the degree of wetness. Means more vapor is there, wetness is also increasing. Increases the wetness. So superheated vapor then expands very slowly, and isentropically when there is no heat transfer. What will happen? It tells total amount of heat is being transferred, but it is expanding. So it is condensation starts beginning. So superheated saturated water line, it is reached. It is the saturated water line. This is the saturated water line, saturated vapor line itself. As per a PS diagram. Now, as the expansion continues below this line, the condensation proceeds gradually to progressive decrease in quality X. And H is equal to S. Flow and isentropic stream expansion of stream from superheated to surface region. Isentropic expansion here, S, P, and the critical pressure, everything is there. Now, the progressive degree of X increases the and progressive decrease of the quality X and increase in their decrease of wetness. Point P represents the point at which the condensation within the vapor just begins. Point P is the point where it is touching and intersecting the condensation line with the vapor. Here, we are from here, the vapor starts formation as per stage diagram itself. Now, however, the steam expands from superheated to the two-phase wet region in the nozzle, but everything is being done from in the nozzle itself. From it is expand superheated state, now two-phase wet state in the nozzle itself.
The expansion occurs so quickly that the vapor cannot condense immediately and it is processed the dry saturated line. Here, dry saturated line, we represent reaches at the point one. Beyond the dry saturated line, still a state exists when the vapor condensate flow is says to be supersaturated and the system is metastable equilibrium. As if the flow still could not confront into the vapor, probably we will say it is supersaturated. It is more than the amount the vapor remains, what remains more than the amount it can carry itself. Which means that it is stable to small disturbance, but unstable to large disturbance. It is stable to small disturbance, but unstable to large disturbance. Wilson line X96 and 91 is the locus of the states below the dry saturated line where the condensation with the vapor requires at the different phases. Let us go. This is the Wilson line itself. This is the dotted line. And this is the critical pressure itself, H and S. And X is equal to the content of the fraction of vapor in the stream, which is quite high, 90.97 to 96.97. And in figure 6 today, we hear this one. The line 01 itself is represent the isentropic expansion slope with equilibrium at every stage of expansion takes place. Line QOR represents the supersaturated expansion in the paper line OR here, this R. O1 is here, OR is there. O1 is, 01 is represents the isentropic expansion and OR represents supersaturated expansion. Here, the paper expands as if the saturated vapor line doesn't exist. So it is independent of the saturated vapor line. It can be seen that the temperature of the saturated vapor is at beyond is FTG, which is less than the saturation temperature T1, corresponding to the pressure P1. The vapor is said to be supercooled when the degree of supercooling T1 is equal to T1 minus TR. Sometimes a degree of supercooling is defined as the ratio of the actual pressure, P1, to the saturated pressure at TR. Sometimes a degree of supersaturation is defined as the ratio of the actual pressure, P1, to the saturation pressure, TR itself. What is going on? The vapor is said to be supercooled. Degree of supercooling TR by T rejected T1 to T uptime. A degree of supersaturation is defined as the ratio of the actual pressure to the saturation pressure TR. The exit velocity for the isentropic flow is V1 is 44.72 into H0 minus H1 to the square root of H0 minus H1. Right? H0 is the stagnation enthalpy and H1 is the enthalpy at different points at the point one where the velocity are being calculated. At the excess velocity of spent flow is V superheated, supersaturated, is equal to H0 minus HR, which is not less but not to the great extent is the difference in the enthalpy drop is small. And PV diagram is shown that the specific volume at exit with supersaturated flow VR, it is constantly less than the specific volume at exit with supersonic isentropic flow V1. Now, the mass flow of steam through a given exit area A1 is given by, for isentropic flow, omega 1 is equal to A into V1 divided by VR itself. For superheated flow, omega superheated mass flow of superheated vapor, A into velocity of superheated vapor divided by velocity at R itself. since V1 is equal to V superheat and V1 is greater than Vr, then omega is less than omega superheat. The mass flow with superheated flow is greater than the mass flow with isentropic flow. This fact improved experimentally due to that discovery of the phenomenon of the superheation itself. With this, I am finishing the gas turbine, steam turbine portion of the heat itself. Now, let us start the diesel generation of heat. Now, let us start the diesel engine itself. Just 1 second, please. Now, what is diesel engine itself? How it is operates? The diesel engine plant generally is not very high capacity plant like steam turbine itself. It is more or less around 2 to 50 megawatt capacity, and not more than that. Yes, I sent for center station for small supply authorities, because you have to, for say, some factory have, which have individual, their same output, and which is supposed to produce their own steam, own power, which both for gas turbine as well as diesel engine, they operate there. And the work, and they are universally adopted to supplement there, which is the main goal, that the hydroelectric or thermal power plant, this is the supplement. This is the most important site of this plant itself, so that we can have this thing reduced. And where the standby generating plants are essential, essential for starting from cold and emergency condition. If certain size in demand is made, then we can use this type of transmission itself. So in order to meet that peak demand, if our plant capacity is not enough for the to meet the peak demand, so we can make this thing at our own condition itself. Just 1 second, please. go through the application of diesel engine in the power field itself. Now, the diesel electric power power plants are chatti used in the following plant, following field itself. That is peak load plant. Where is the load is at the highest, diesel plants can be used in combination with thermal and hydro plants at peak load condition plant itself. What is peak load plant? Well, our existing condition is not enough to justify the peak load or prevent the peak load, then we are used in this, they are used in combination with the thermal or hydro plant itself. They can be started or stopped in a short notice to meet the equipment itself. Mobile plant. Sometimes diesel plants are movable, kind of trailers, or in railways, or in trucks, can be used so that even for the temporary emergency purpose, such as supplying power to the large civil generating plant itself. In the main unit phase or cannot cope up with the demand, a diesel plant can supply the necessary power. For example, if the water available in a hydro plant is not adequately available due to less rainfall, the diesel station can operate in parallel to generate the shortfall in the power. So, what has happened? Hydro plant water is not sufficient, but your demand is as it is due to less rainfall or like this. So, you can operate in parallel with to generate the shortfall in there. So, we are operating in parallel to generate the shortfall in demand itself. Emergency plant. During power interruption in a vital unit like a key industrial plant or a client. Vital unit like a key industrial plant or a hospital, a diesel electric plant can be used to generate the needed required power itself. In the absence of main grid, the diesel plant can be installed to supply power in a small town. We can supply in a small power town in power. In case of time, electricity from the main grid becomes available, diesel unit can be shifted to some other area which needs a power on a small scale. So the diesel plant is called nursery station. And where you are, where certain amount of power is reserved, you can go and do this, use this diesel plant itself. And starting station, diesel unit can be used to run the auxiliaries like FD, ID fans, and BP, VFF fans like this. Full different fans for the starting is large steam power plant itself. The central station, diesel electric plant can be used as the central station where the capacity is required is small. Advantage and disadvantage of diesel power plant. Following are the advantages of diesel power station, and it is easy to design and install this electric station itself. They are easily available in standard capacities and they are small to load changes without much difficulty itself. So, what is this? First of all, easy to design and easy to install. They are easily available in standard capacities. So, if you don't accept a very high capacity, a certain few megawatts capacity is reserved, so you can make this type of diesel unit and available to you. They can respond to load changes without much difficulties itself. There are less standby losses. Load change you can refer without much difficulties. You can increase the speed of the diesel plant, increase the by applying more diesel, and you can use up to a certain limit, you can increase the load itself. There standby losses can be comparatively less here. They occupy less space. They doesn't require more space like a big steam power plant, and that can be used very easily. They can be start and stop within a moment. It requires less cooling water than the steam water, so you don't need to locate it near a pond or near a big river or pond like this. The cost of manufacturing, what is the manufacturing installation, is comparatively less. Less operating and supervising staff required. Generally, diesel plant can anybody can run, just switching on, switching off, and maintaining the flow level of the diesel. high efficiency of energy conservation of diesel to electricity. So almost 94-95% energy is being conserved from fuel to electricity itself, where steam plants over 50-60% is quite high, quite okay. Efficiency at part loads is also higher. Less civil engineering work is required, almost nothing. Generally, you are to keep the diesel power plant in a mobile unit. This can be located near the load center itself. So capital loss, that's all. The capital loss is less. Less operating and supervising staff is required. Okay. There is no ash handling plant. Diesel doesn't generate ash. There is no ash handling plant in diesel. There is no ash handling plant system. So easier duplication system is desired. But there are some disadvantages in installing the diesel plants also for power. Operating cost is high because the fuel, which is the diesel, is much costlier than the coal itself. Maintenance and lubrication cost is required. Maintenance requires high vigorous steel because a qualified personnel who know this part, and lubrication cost is required is more because everywhere you have to present a considerable amount of money for the proper lubrication of the plant itself. Capacity is not very high, cannot be of any fixed size itself.
The additional knowledge is created itself, but sometimes it may problem itself. Cannot supply overload. If you demand more than the plant, it cannot help you. And the emission of diesels is anywhere you are inside the factory or outside the factory is extremely unhygienic itself.
So
let us go through the types of
the diesel plant itself.
In a diesel plant supply, air is fast compressed to a high pressure itself and a small volume of compression into ratio and a small volume. Compression ratio varies from 13 to as high as 13 to 22 PS because it at which the hot air temperature is more than the self-ignition temperature of the fuel oil. So we don't have to ignite the diesel. It will be ignited by its own self-ignition temperature, which is sprayed into the, which you have to only spray into the compressed air in fine atomized form. The combustion products expand doing work on the piston till the exhaust valve opens. Exhaust of the products then take place, and at the end of which fresh air is again taken into the cylinder, and this cycle repeats itself. There is no spark plug. Fuel oil spray burns. There is no spark plug is required. Fuel oil spray burns in the hot compressed air, and hence a diesel engine also called a compression ignition or CI engine. Diesel engines can be four-stroke and two-stroke. Horizontal can be vertical, in-cylinder, multi-cylinder, natural, saturated, and oversaturated. Rail layout. What is the general layout? The cross-section of a air-cooled diesel IC engine with principal parts shown in figure 4. The essential components are shown in 2. The consists of the following element, engine itself. It is the main component of the plant and directly coupled with the generator itself. Engine valve is there. This is the engine port. This is the exhaust valve, exhaust port. Inlet valve, inlet port, exhaust valve, exhaust port. This is the exhaust port itself. This is the inlet port itself. This is the air chamber at the inlet. This is the chamber at the outlet itself. And this is the cylinder head. Now, this is the cooling fins. Here we have fins situated here, which is surrounding the surrounded throughout this engine itself, which releases a considerable amount of heat by radiation itself. Next, this is the piston and the wrist fin, over which the connecting rod is being fixed there. And connecting rod itself is shown here.
This is the connecting rod and crank pin itself. And this is the crankshaft and cylinder. This is the inside the cylinder, which is fully closed itself. So piston is moving from here to here, reciprocating in the reciprocating pump. Then crankshaft is inside the crankshaft, and as a diesel engine, it can be of multiple cylinder, not a single cylinder, as far as the capacity is given. And crankshaft has different eccentricities with which it can run the diesel, different diesel plants simultaneously or synchronized or simultaneously one after another itself. And this is the crank itself. And diesel engine is the gas powered plant structure. What is the what we are getting out of it? Now the combined compressed air in bottle itself is the cylinder itself, and air from the air compression it got the compressed air. From here it goes, the air goes to the fuel filter, and from the engine part itself, fuel filter, and this is the fuel in the fuel injection pump here. Here what we are doing, just 1 second. So what we have in the beginning is a compressed air bottle and air compressor itself. From the bottle it goes direct to the fuel filter, and there is one is the air filter from which it is coming, when air filter and fuel, where there is a fuel tank here, and fuel tank comes for any overflow it will come back, and from the fuel pump its fuel tank comes from here to here itself, and then fuel the tank, then from there the fuel filter it goes to the fuel injection pump here and goes the generator itself, and this is the exhaust point itself. And this is the oil sump. There is the oil sump here, and auxiliary oil generator itself. And then oil filtrifier, cooling tower, oil filtrifier, cooling tower, and then goes to the heat exchanger itself. Thus, the jacket warm water pump, the super surge tank, is also provided here. Well, so far, we are finishing our classes here. Nobody attended, only I have brought, okay. That is the finish of this hearing.